We have hitherto considered the tendency to the extension of the working day, the werewolf's hunger for surplus labour in a department where the monstrous exactions cause capital at last to be bound by the chains of legal regulations. Now, let us cast a glance at certain branches of production in which the exploitation of labour is either free from fetters to this day, or was so yesterday. This section is mainly excerpts taken from the factory reports on those sections of industry that were not included in the Factory Acts of 1850. For this section in the video, I will quote some of them in full, but I would advise that you read it for yourself to get a full idea of some of the horrible conditions people faced and some of the practices that were performed by capitalists to maximise their profits. Children of 9 or 10 years are dragged from their squalid beds at 2, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and compelled to work for a bare subsistence until 10, 11 or 12 at night, their limbs wearing away, their frames dwindling, their faces whitening, and their humanity absolutely sinking into a stone-like torpor, utterly horrible to contemplate. What can be thought of a town which holds a public meeting to petition that the period of labour for men should be diminished to 18 hours a day? William Wood, 9 years old, was 7 years when he began to work. He carried ready-moulded articles into the drying room, afterwards bringing back the empty mould. He came to work every day in the week at 6 a.m. and left off about 9 p.m. I work till 9 o'clock at night, 6 days in the week. I have not always an hour for dinner. I have only half an hour sometimes, on Thursdays, Friday and Saturday. Dr. Greenough states that the average duration of life in the pottery district of Stoke-on-Trent and Woolstanton is extraordinarily short, although in the district of Stoke, only 36.6% and in Woolstanton, only 30.4% of the adult male population above 20 are employed in the potteries. Among the men of that age in the first district, more than half. In the second, nearly 2 out of 5 of the whole deaths are the result of pulmonary diseases among the potters. Each successive generation of potters is more dwarfed and less robust than the preceding one. In like manner, another doctor, Mr. Mabeen, states, since he began to practice amongst the potters 25 years ago, he has observed a marked degeneration, especially shown in diminution of stature and breadth. The potters as a class, both men and women, represent a degenerated population, both physically and morally. They are, as a rule, stunted in growth, ill-shaped, and frequently ill-formed in the chest. They become prematurely old and are certainly short-lived. They are phlegmatic and bloodless and exhibit their debility of constitution by obstinate attacks of dyspepsia and disorders of the liver and kidneys and by rheumatism. But of all diseases, they are especially prone to chest disease, to pneumonia, bronchitis and asthma. One form would appear peculiar to them and is known as potter's asthma or potter's consumption. Scrofula attacking the glands or bones or other parts of the body is a disease of 2/3 or more of the potters. The manufacture of lucifer matches dates from 1833, from the discovery of a method of applying phosphorus to the match itself. Since 1845, this manufacture has rapidly developed in England and has extended especially amongst the thickly populated parts of London, as well as in Manchester, Birmingham, Liverpool, Bristol, Norwich, Newcastle and Glasgow. With it has spread the form of lockjaw, which a Vienna physician in 1845 discovered to be a disease peculiar to lucifer matchmakers. Half the workers are children under 13 and young persons under 18. The manufacture is on account of its unhealthiness and unpleasantness in such bad odour that only the most miserable part of the labouring class, half-staff widows and so forth, deliver up their children to it. The ragged, half-starved, untaught children of the witnesses that the Commissioner White examined in 1863, 270 were under 18, 50 under 10, 10 only 8, and 5 only 6 years old. A range of the working day from 12 to 14 or 15 hours, night labour, irregular meal times, meals for the most part taken in the very workrooms that are pestilent with phosphorus. Dante would have found the worst horrors of his Inferno surpassed in this manufacture. In the manufacture of paper hangings, the coarser sorts are printed by machine, the finer by block printing. The most active business month are from the beginning of October to the end of April. During this time, the work goes on fast and furious, without intermission, from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. or further into the night. Last winter, 6 out of 19 girls were away from ill health at one time from overwork. I have to bawl to keep them awake. I have seen when the children could none of them keep their eyes open for the work. Indeed, none of us could. I'm 13. We worked last winter till 9 p.m. and the winter before till 10. I used to cry with sore feet every night last winter. That boy of mine, when he was 7 years old, I used to carry him on my back to and fro through the snow, and he used to have 16 hours a day. I have often knelt down to feed him as he stood by the machine, for he could not leave it or stop. We work on with no stoppage for meals, so that the day's work of 10 and a half hours is finished by 4:30 p.m. And all after that is overtime. We seldom leave off working before 6 p.m, so that we are rarely working overtime the whole year round. For all these, children and adults alike, the average work for the last 18 months has been at least 78 and a half hours a week. For the 6 weeks ending May 2nd, 1862, the average was higher, 84 hours a week. The work of a London journeyman baker begins, as a rule, at about 11 at night. And that hour he makes the dough, a laborious process which lasts from half an hour to three quarters of an hour, according to the size of the batch or the labour bestowed upon it. He then lies down upon the kneading board, which is also the covering of the trough in which the dough is made, and with a sack under him and another rolled up as a pillow, he sleeps for a couple of hours. He is then engaged in rapid and continuous labour. The temperature of the bakehouse ranges from about 75 to upwards of 90 degrees. The operatives belonging to the full price bakers at the west end of the town generally begin work at 11 p.m. and are engaged in making the bread up until 8 o'clock the next morning. They are then engaged all day long, up to 4, 5, 6 and as late as 7 o'clock in the evening, carrying out the bread. They may have, after they have done their work sometimes, only 4 or 5 hours sleep before they begin again. It will be understood that the report of the commission classes journeymen bakers amongst the short-lived labourers who rarely reach the age of 42. Marx here also briefly highlights the practice of adulteration of food and drink, or the adding of other substances to food. Human sweat mixed with the pus and discharge from abscesses, cobwebs, dead black beetles and putrid German yeast, cheap chemical powders, sand and other agreeable mineral ingredients. So not only does the production become cheaper for the capitalist by adding cheaper ingredients and maintaining poor working conditions, but the very products the labourers must consume for their own reproduction becomes less nutritious. He also points out that Irish journeymen bakers successfully agitated and organised against Sunday and night work, and eventually, as a result of this movement, day labour alone was successfully established in some counties. Marx mentions that a Scottish train driver was convicted of manslaughter after his train derailed, killing hundreds of people. The driver had fallen asleep after being continually required to work for up to 50 hours without a break. In the last week of June 1863, all the London daily papers published a paragraph with the sensational heading, "Death from Simple Overwork." It dealt with the death of a milliner, Mary Ann Walkley, 20 years of age, employed in a highly respectable dressmaking establishment, exploited by a lady with the pleasant name of Elise. The old, often told story was once more recounted. This girl worked during the season often 30 hours without a break, while her failing labour power was revived by occasional supplies of sherry, port or coffee. It was just now the height of the season. It was necessary to conjure up in the twinkling of an eye the gorgeous dresses for the noble ladies bidden to the ball in honour of the newly imported Princess of Wales. Mary Ann Walkley had worked without intermission for 26 and a half hours with 60 other girls, 30 in one room that only afforded one third of the cubic feet of air required for them. At night they slept in pairs in one of the stifling holes into which the bedroom was divided by partitions of board. And this was one of the best millinery establishments in London. Mary Ann Walkley fell ill on the Friday, died on the Sunday, without, to the astonishment of Madame Elise, having previously completed the work in hand. We will take the blacksmith as a type. If the poets were true, there is no man so hearty, so merry as the blacksmith. He rises early and strikes his sparks before the sun. He eats and drinks and sleeps as no other man. Working in moderation, he is, in fact, in one of the best human positions, physically speaking. But we follow him into the city or town, and we see the stress of work on that strong man. And what then is his position and the death rate of his country? In Marylebone, blacksmiths die at the rate of 31 per thousand per annum, or 11 above the mean of the male adults in the country in its entirety. The occupation, instinctive almost as a portion of human art, unobjectable as a branch of human industry, is made by mere excess of work, the destroyer of the man. He can strike so many blows per day, walk so many steps, breathe so many breaths, produce so much work. He is made to strike so many more blows, to walk so many more steps, to breathe so many more breaths per day, and to increase altogether a fourth of his life. He meets the effort. The result is, he dies at 37.